In this episode of the Evil God Monster of Abraham series, we'll cover Genesis chapter 5 in the Book of Death, the chapter in which Tom begat Harry, who begat Dick, who ad nauseum begat. Boring, useless, and wasteful. But we'll make it fun. Stick around. Hi there. Did you know that if you take the first word from the first 10 of my videos and put them in a sentence, it reads, "No moss on green hats for battery-flavored old babies," which in the original tongue translates into, "Hit that subscribe button and then that little notification bell. Like and share, people. Help spread my nutbaggery." Honestly, that's really what the translation says. Now, on with the show. Okay, so rather than beat a dead horse here, I'm just going to lightly whip it a little. The misogyny, which began in chapter 2, no surprise, continues on to chapter 5. How so, you ask? Well, chapter 5 is essentially a lineage, men and women having children, and those children go on to have children. Well, wait, that's not really what happens here. Men have the children, no wives or mothers are ever mentioned, and these children go on to have other men who also have children. Throughout chapter 5, not a single woman is named. Women are only referred to in the beginning when it says God created male and female, and after that only when stating that a man had many sons and daughters. Other than that, they're not worth mention. We all know the efforts which go into making a baby. Man does his part, then the woman carries the child, births the child, tends the child, etc. Who changes the diapers? Who makes the clothes? Who cooks for the child? Right, the mother. In almost every culture the world over, women bear the brunt of childbearing. Yet not a single woman is named, nor given any kind of credit in chapter 5. Men spread their seed, men have sons who have names and go on to have sons, while women remain nameless and are referred to only when stating that a man had sons and daughters. Almost like an afterthought. No surprise though, right? Given how the text and its followers treat women, either as slaves or birthing ovens, and often as both. Okay, the dead horse called misogyny has now been properly tenderized. So, on with the secret code. Okay, so in Deep Space Nine, the Grand Nagus, sort of like the King of the Ferengi, goes into the wormhole of the prophets and comes back changed. Instead of being his usual greedy self, he becomes very benevolent and no longer lusts after latinum and gold. He even rewrites their sacred book, The Rules of Acquisition, turning it from a book of greed to a book of love and kindness. Quark, one of the main characters, doesn't believe it and thinks it's all a scam. He thinks the Nega is doing all this as some kind of scheme, or that there must be some kind of hidden message of truth, read that as greed, hidden somewhere in the book. So to that end, he says to his brother Rom, "It must be some kind of code. Read me the first word of every rule." Rom opens the book and reads each word as he flips the pages. "If never, keep profit, a good smile, honesty." Quark leaps to his feet and says, "Aha! If never keep profit, a good smile, honesty." "Well, what does it mean?" Rom asks. Quark responds, "It means absolutely nothing." But wait, in their case, it does kind of mean something. Following the motif of the story, we could interpret it as, if you never keep profit, you could always have a good smile. You could infer that the next line formed in such a manner might be, "Honesty is the best policy." But we just kind of made that up, huh? Right here. Just like the Christians. In this case, it was not a message the Ferengi were wanting to hear, so to them it meant nothing. Similarly, people seem to think that there's a hidden code in the names of the men listed in the begats of chapter 5 of Genesis, and that it's not just a waste of space. If you believe, then it could mean everything. Validation for your beliefs and proof that God is there trying to communicate with us in secret, hidden ways. If you don't believe, then it's just a bunch of nonsense. So let's take a look at the secret message in Genesis 5. What could it possibly be? The 11 spices to the Colonel's secret recipe? 10 ways to earn money working from home? Or maybe it's something actually useful, like telling them to boil their water before they drank it. Perhaps the atomic weight of boron? Nope. The 10 names from Adam to Noah when put together in a sentence and translated means, "Man is appointed, a mortal man of sorrow is born. The glory of God shall come down, instructing that his death shall bring those in despair comfort and rest." Well, at least that's what it means according to the BibleCodes.org, and you get essentially the same thing from the YouTube video Hidden Message in Genesis 5. Is that a miracle? Or is it more likely that one had it first and the other saw it and repeated it? Either way, It's uncanny. It gives me the tingles. But here in The Messiah in Genesis 5 by 119 Ministries, it says something completely different. Let's go through it step by step.
Adam simply means a man. The literal meaning of Seth is the word substituted.
Okay, so Adam means man. But you'll notice later when they say the word man, they don't use Adam. None of the words with man in them as part of the translation have Adam in the word. Just an interesting point. According to this, Seth literally means substituted. Really? That's what you name your kid? That's a ridiculous name for a child. Hey, substituted, how's it hanging today? Over here at BibleCodes.org, they say Seth means appointed. So is it substituted or appointed? Apologists, please don't embarrass yourself by trying to explain that they're the same thing, because we know they're not.
Enosh is usually rendered as a man, but it is a plural function, meaning people or the human race. The root word related to Enosh means very sick or incurable. So the meaning when all is considered is incurable man or very sick human race. So far with Adam, Seth, and Enosh, we have a man substituted incurable man.
Enosh means either people, incurable, or a mortal of man. You see where I'm going with this? No Adam in the word Enosh, by the way. Not only is it a real stretch to imagine that this list of names is an actual message from God, but can you imagine giving children's names like this? Daddy, why did you name me very sick human race? Well, because we were making a string of names in what will be a dead language that, when you put them together later, will mean absolutely nothing. Of course.
Does this fit Yeshua? Here is some scripture to consider.
By Yeshua, he means Jesus. Super eye roll. So at this point, he's going to start just chucking random scriptures from both the Old and New Testament to try to shoehorn this one in. This is a perfect example of modern Christians trying to jam Jesus into the Old Testament, trying to create prophecy where none existed.
Yeshua substituting incurable man. Isaiah 53, verse 5. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. 1 Peter 2:24. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. Our Messiah substituted his perfect self for our sin. We were incurable and very sick, and through him, we are healed.
In this case, his interpretation is a man substituted incurable man, which he uses Jesus as the man who substituted himself for our sins. And then he justifies it with the aforementioned random scriptures. Mediocre attempt at best.
Now we need to determine the Hebrew meaning of Canaan and Mahalalel. Canaan literally means possession or possessing. The root word means to erect. Mahalalel means praise of God. The root word means shining light.
Canaan means possessing. Very sick human race, quit picking on to erect a light, or I'm going to tell substituted on you. You see how dumb that's starting to sound?
John chapter 8. Again, Yeshua spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Psalm 119:5. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path.
Of course, here he goes jamming Christ into it everywhere it mentions light. Erect a light in book 5 of Genesis somehow means Jesus, because in John, literally hundreds of years later, it says Jesus claimed he was the light of the world. Why didn't they just say Jesus then in the beginning? Why the wordplay and the obfuscation? Why go through all the trouble to hide a scripture, even one as poorly constructed as this one, when they walked around and talked about this stuff all the time? It's not like it's some kind of secret. If they wanted to be mysterious, they could have turned and broken the fourth wall and said, person reading this book later, Jesus is the light, the Son of God, buy stock in Yahoo, etc., etc., yada, yada. But no, obfuscation and metaphor. And wait, what does Canaan mean according to the BibleCodes.org? Well, Canaan means sorrow is born. clearly a different translation, right? Can you imagine having that embroidered on his tiny little booties? Sorrow is born. Aw, how cute. We should have them Bronze Aged. An indoctrinated individual might be amazed that hundreds of years later this alluded to that, or they might be convinced that that one thing meant the other, but to someone who has put any real objective mental effort into it can clearly see this is a bunch of made-up, after-the-fact nonsense. The actual ancient translations are so hard to find or are so obscure that it makes it easy for people to bend it however they like, as exemplified by these two different translations by two completely different believers. Make it up. Say it with confidence or authority, and people will believe it. And this is not really about having an education or being intelligent or not. People believe this nonsense because they want to. I have to say that no matter how intelligent you are, even if you are the tops at all the Mensa parties, it doesn't matter if you want to believe it. If you want to believe this gibberish, and you want to find power and mystery in these words, and you don't have a problem being dishonest with yourself, you'll find a way. I'm not going to bore you by making you watch the rest of the video. Let's go ahead and skip to the end. Look at the differences between these two translations. Man is appointed. A mortal man of sorrow is born. The glory of God shall come down, instructing that his death shall bring those in despair comfort and rest. BibleCodes.org. But according to the other interpretations, a man substituted incurable man and erected the shining light of God by coming down to teach. He is the branch bringing mighty youthful rest. The perfect, immutable word of God? Clearly less than perfect and quite muted. Some people claim the Bible holds mysteries which we're still unable to comprehend at this time, which means it's literally trash to the billions of people who've come along before and can't understand it or crack the code. Isaac Newton, genius by all rights, studied the Bible as hard as he did the sciences, and despite cracking gravity, he never found any meaningful codes or hidden messages in the Bible. It's all a distraction, and Occam's razor really does apply. All these begats are just someone trying to validate Noah by creating a string of names between him and Adam. Trying to shove Jesus in there is just embarrassing. So here's an entire chapter wasted to tell us nothing more than Noah was a direct descendant of Adam. 10 generations of parentage, literally without mention of the wives and mothers who birthed these men. And daughters are only mentioned as an afterthought. Typical of the evil god monster of Abraham and his book of death. And remember, the secret message from my first 10 videos says, a gambling crab walks high in the panties on Tuesday, which of course is a subtle nuanced translation of hit the subscribe button and that little notification bell. So what do you think? Do you buy the notion that there's a hidden message buried in the begats of the Bible? Let me know in the comments below. Thank you for all your support. Please head over to Patreon and show me some love. Do the thing at the place. For the guy, I'm the guy. Thank you and take care.